So we are viewing a part of history that doesn't really get talked about too much. This is the time period during the early 40s after Pearl Harbor. A number of Japanese Americans, they were in these camps here. And they faced a lot of suspicion because of their ethnicity. And life out here was pretty desolate. This is a memorial to the Japanese internment camps who lived right here. This was their barracks. And then you see the backdrop here, one of the most iconic shots of California, Mount Whitney in the background, the Sierras. It's just so desolate out here. And it's interesting to see this historic site in the middle of nowhere. This right here is the watchtower. Because the Japanese, they weren't allowed to go off base. The Ford truck here, and then behind us are the men's halls, the areas where they did laundry and things like that. They had 10,000 people here. It's like a little community. Look at this. Look how big it was. All kinds of barracks. Here in front of the mess hall, this was the old school style dinner alarm. They would ring that in the morning, and they had a number of incarcerated Japanese Americans here following the bombing of Hawaii. Imagine just living out here in the middle of nowhere like this.
You get people confined in a small space like that, and you have no one to fight. You can't fight these military people with guns, so you attack each other, blame each other.
So all of these tensions began to boil.
Some of it had to do with the protest, but like any activity where you have a demonstration, other factors enter in.
A group of people, they ended up in front of the camp entrance. The MPs became worried that they were going to be rushed. And so a couple of them shot their rifles into the crowd. Two young men were shot and killed.
Will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. That since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
Come home from church, and then we kept hearing, you know, Pearl Harbor was bombed, Pearl Harbor was bombed. I had no idea where Pearl Harbor was. My geography was not that sophisticated. I had no idea, and my father said, oh, there's going to be trouble.
And so the following day, the FBI had come over and knocked on the door, and they just opened the door and knocked on it, opened the door and came in. Said, we are from the FBI and we're gonna go through your house for contraband. So they were going through everything, and you know, in them days, the Japanese all used to have the steamer trunk, and that's where they kept all their valuables, you know. And so, right after Pearl Harbor, what we did was we took my dad's uniform and we put it right on top of the steam, in the top of this steamer trunk there. And the FBI came in, made my dad open the steamer trunk, and they said, what the hell is this? Pulled out the uniform, and I was standing right there. It aggravated the hell out of me. And so my dad said, oh, that's my uniform. They said, this is an American uniform. So my dad said, well, I was in the American Army. I went to France. Oh, the American Army never took Japs. And they threw the damn uniform on the floor, stepped all over it, walked through it and everything.
One of the things was my uncle was taken by the FBI fairly soon after the December 7th, and a lot of my father's friends were taken in. Since he was active in the community, he thought he was going to go too, and so he bought a leather bag, and my brother stenciled G.E. Iwasaki on it, and he had his things all packed and by the door of our house in case the FBI came. He was going to be ready. When I wake up, the first thing I would do was to go and check to see whether the bag was there.
In the weeks following, Japan won numerous battles in Asia. Newspapers were filled with these reports, along with sensational rumors about Japanese Americans spying and sabotaging military bases. Even Dr. Seuss, the famed children's book author, who was generally liberal in his views, penned political cartoons that cast suspicion against Japanese Americans on the West Coast.
Our West Coast became a potential combat zone.
The atmosphere for those of Japanese ancestry was uncomfortable and hostile, and many feared the possibility of hate crimes against them.
There was a worry of being targeted, or there was rumors, all kinds of rumors. So we had a Japanese book, a great big book like this. And my mother and my father treasured that book because it had the history of the Yoshi family. It was written up by somebody, I don't know. But they were afraid that if they held a book like that in their house, they would be suspected of espionage. So they tore the book and built a fire in the backyard and secretly burned all of the books. I know that happened. And so I knew about that book, you know, that they treasured it. Is like a family heirloom, but they decided among themselves that that's the best way to make sure that we don't have to go to prison.
Influenced by intense political pressure from West Coast politicians, farmers, and labor unions, the president signed Executive Order 9066 on February 19th, 1942, 10 weeks after the Pearl Harbor attack.
That is why the commanding general of the Western Defense Command determined that all Japanese within the coastal area should move inland.
As a result, the U.S. military removed and incarcerated over 110,000 Japanese Americans from Alaska, Washington, Oregon, California, and Arizona. Ironically, in Hawaii, where the attack occurred, only a handful of the 160,000 Japanese Americans were locked up, while the majority stayed to help with the war effort.
We only took what we had to take, because we only had one suitcase that we can take. And of course, in that suitcase, you're trying to put maybe a sheet or so that you can have for sleeping. And the rest is your clothes and your shoes. One suitcase for the rest of your life that we thought isn't a lot, a space to put things. And that's the way we traveled, and with a tag on the suitcase and a tag on our body.
I can always picture the sun was setting and the crowd was gathering where the people, some of your friends, and there were hundreds of people there. Some of them were there to say goodbye. Others came just for the curiosity. And it just had sort of a circus feeling about it. And people were looking for their friends to say goodbye to. And finally, we got on the train. I remember pronouncing the last name and help going up the train. And I said, thank you for your help. He said, don't forget it, thank you. And it was such an odd feeling.
The day of evacuation, we all assembled down at the Pasadena railroad station. For me, it was very humiliating, because we were being carried out of Pasadena in a disgraceful way. I mean, we were being disgraced, actually.
Pictures like that, just really, when you think about it, very, very sad, but it was such a, it's hard to explain the kind of feeling, the atmosphere of that time.
We walked with our suitcases to the train depot, and there were guards with rifles.
They had two MPs on each side, and they had bayonets on them. Why they had bayonets, I'll never know.
The morning we left, it was sprinkling. My sister had overheard this lady say, look at, even the heavens are crying for us.
The great trek begins. A Jap caravan heads for the government's war relocation project in the Owens Valley. A voluntary migration. It's in no sense a concentration camp, but a city with its front yard in the Snow Peak Sierra Nevadas. Here, eventually, 12,000 will live and work.
Seeing the guard tower and the barbed wire fence, and this blew my mind to think that we were going to be behind those wires.
My mother and father lived at the time in the Owens Valley, and they saw the people getting off the buses. My mother said, I was so upset by that. These people don't belong there. They're American citizens.
They are not prisoners. They are not internees. They are merely dislocated people.
Guided by very young soldiers. One time, soldier stopped me. Hey, you! You wanna talk to me? And he said, yeah. Are you a human being? I said, yes, don't you think so? Yeah, you look like a human being. But when I came from South Carolina, they said that the Jap is not a human being. They are like a gorilla. You people look like a human being. And you people all wearing beautiful clothes.
Yes, do that next time. After this 10.
The first thing that they told us to do was to grab a bag and put straws in the bag.
And that was our bid for that night.
That night, we had a big old whirlwind come through there. And I thought that it was gonna take the roof off because I've never seen anything like that, been any place like that. And I had a pillow over my ears. But when I woke up in the morning and looked at the little mirror that we had sitting on one of the inside boards, you could just see where the tears ran down. We were just full of dust from the windstorm that went through, because it all came through the flooring. And then I heard some people, the scorpions came through and they got bit or whatever. Stories like that. We were lucky we didn't have that.
But the first night, all of a sudden I realized that, my God, there are holes in the roof. I look up and I see the sky. I thought, my God, it's so beautiful.
And that night, there was a pretty big windstorm. Well, next morning when I got up, I looked at my mattress, and right where my head was, it's still all white, but then the rest of it was all covered with sand.
It was hot in the summer, bone-chilling in the winter, and there was always the wind. There was always the wind.
It was very, very dusty. Oh, you know, the dust was powdery fine, and they were, if I recall, it was about 3-4 inches deep. So you just, every time you take a step, you just have a puff of smoke, I mean, of dust. And if you have even the slightest breeze, wow, you know, you're in a like a fog. When you go to the mess hall to eat, of course you can, when you chew the food, you can feel the grit of the sand. And it's amazing, even that, you get used to it.
Being one of the first groups there, I'm sure a lot of the facilities weren't up to snuff yet as far as toilet facilities and the barracks and so forth, that they were still building a lot of the things that we got there. And the conditions were probably not as good as they were maybe later on, although they probably still weren't very outstanding. I know my mom said that first week there, everyone got diarrhea. And then I remember somebody calling it the Manzanar runs. But she said that this elderly Issei first generation woman came up to her and said, you know, they're going to poison us and we're all going to die. We'll never leave this place. And my mother told her she didn't think that was true because she didn't think America was that way. And, you know, it was the food rather than the fact they were actually trying to poison us. So But that feeling probably was real to some of the older people there because they didn't know how they'd be treated.
There were some incidents that, you know, for instance, there were latrines around barracks and things where you had to go, and they had no partitions at all. And the women, particularly Nisei girls particularly, were very modest, and they just dreaded going to the bathroom. And they would do all kinds of things to try to not, you know, go when other people are there. To the point where there was one enterprising girl who somehow found a large cardboard box. And when she had to go to the bathroom, she would carry that and put it around her when she went to the bathroom.
Well, in going to the camp, one of the things I did, which I don't know if anyone else did the same thing, I expected to be in a barbed wire enclosure, and it turned out to be that way. But the thing that worried me was how they would treat us there. And I wanted to be able to get out of camp if necessary, if treatment was as bad as it might have been. And so as we left home, I mean, the last thing I grabbed out of the toolbox was a pair of wire cutters. Put in my pocket and went. And I had occasion to use those wire cutters only once. They had bits of insulation, Celtex, bits of it, piled up in a pile on the other side of the barbed wire fence that they had us in. See? And I wanted to go and get those pieces of Celtex to insulate a part of the barrack, the quarters they had us in. Well, I thought, well, the best thing to do is to get out there and bring that in inside the wire. Well, I tried crawling through that barbed wire, and I got caught on it once and twice. And I said, well, the heck with it, and I took the plier out, and I snapped the... Well, that was an unexpected surprise. All that barbed wire was taut. And so when I snapped it, that thing goes boing, like that. Loud sound, and I thought, oh my gosh, the first thing I did was to go flat on my stomach so they couldn't see me because of the sagebrush. And I thought someone might show up, so I lay there for a while. Nobody seemed to notice, so I got up and went through the barbed wire fence this time with considerable ease and brought most of that inside the wire, which I could take it back to my apartment.
Uncle Sam and we Americans, we like to use euphemistic words or invent words if we think certain other words are too harsh. So they call them relocation centers. They were America's versions of concentration camps.
The daily life in Manzanar was just like any other life, except we didn't have any freedom. And we didn't have any privacy.
We were all in a room, which was only 20 by 25 feet, men and women. We did finally put up sheets to divide the room.
We all had to take a shower in the same place with a lot of other people. And I just couldn't get myself to go take a shower in that place.
People like my mother would stay up late, hoping to take a shower where her neighbors weren't around.
My mom just kept blaming herself. She kept telling us, it'll be over, but I know every day is killing her.
I didn't like what was being done to the Japanese people, and they needed teachers. I went to the placement office and told them I wanted to go to Manzanar. They looked at me as though I had taken leave of my senses, but I got to go.
In the science classes, I remember a teacher says, pretend this is a Bunsen burner.
We didn't have a flag, so we would use the salute to an empty corner. And finally, one day, one of the boys said, well, why don't we draw a flag?
It must have been difficult for a teacher to talk about democracy when we're put into a place like that.
We were American kids in there. This is an American town.
were not allowed to leave the camp to go play at high school outside of Manzanar, so we always had to be the home team. The home team advantage, yeah.
The worst memory was that we were prisoners.
There's nothing you can do about it. Then you just accept it. That's one of the things that got us through those hard times. Shikataganai. Nothing can be done. What can we do?
The Japanese people appreciate nature. So eventually the people got together and put in lawns and gardens.
Anything to kind of beautify and forget about the hardship a little bit.
And then they also had a dance band. They were called the Jive Bombers.
There was a very popular song at the time, Don't Fence Me In. And then I thought, gee, it sure is fitting that we're in a place like this within the barbed wire.
Relocation centers are not normal and probably never can be. Home life is disrupted.
Although government films acknowledged that life was not ideal, they never addressed the injustice of the camps. Two-thirds of those incarcerated were U.S. citizens, and there were no hearings or trials held to determine if they did anything wrong or were dangerous.
I just felt that all this liberty and crap was all crap. So you read so much about democracy and all this, and it was a real eye-opener to see what could happen to citizens and what the citizenship mean. Because it just bothered the heck out of me.
Give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the high-flying city that I love. Don't fence me in. Let me be by myself in the evening breeze. Listen to the murmur of the tall concrete. Send me off forever, but I ask you, please, don't fence me in. Now put the spin in my wheels, let me run away with my thoughts. Don't fence me in. Say freedom is the word, heaven's own work of art. Don't fence me in. I wanna ride to the ridge where the view commences. Gaze at the moon till I lose my senses. My heart stays on the road cause I can't stand fences. Don't fence me in.
Don't fence me in.
do what everybody wants you to do, and then you'll be okay. So the whole thing was to study hard, be a nice guy, and eventually you'll be accepted. That was their whole philosophy of life. The Issei particularly were that way, but I said Issei are different because they cannot become American citizens anyway. That's why they would say that, yes, accommodate, and eventually you'll be all right. The Isseis were very, they were treated, especially the early Isseis were treated very badly. But yes, the Nisseis sort of accepted it. Their mentality was very similar to the Isseis. That is to be quiet and just accept everything that comes along, do your best, and eventually you'll be okay.
An online encyclopedia describes Kibei of the early 1940s as the people thought of as likely threats against the U.S. because they were considered a dangerous element with suspected loyalties to the emperor and to Japan. So, just to protect myself as not to be considered a dangerous element, I refer to myself as a Sengokibei, an after-the-war returnee.
What is the state of civil rights for Asian Pacific Americans? Hello and welcome to Comcast Newsmakers. I'm Candace Kelly, and joining me is Priscilla Ochida, National Executive Director of the Japanese American Citizens League. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Now, what's interesting is that your organization was founded in 1929 at a time when there were over 100 anti-immigration laws in place. And I just wanted your opinion about what you think about those particular times and what's going on now in terms of anti-immigration policies.
Well, we're finding that xenophobic policies actually go back to 1882. And by the time we were formed in 1929, there were laws against we couldn't own land, we couldn't become United States citizens. If we married an American citizen, that citizen lost their citizenship. There were threats of deportation. So you're seeing a lot of the same things that are happening today in the immigration arguments.
My motivations for getting into JCR, well, first of all, I think it was social. I'm married now and I have a couple of kids. But it's nice to sit down with other Nikkei and just chat, share food, enjoy, and the JCL provided that here. And also I think some of the work that the JCL is doing I thought was quite worthy of support. So I got involved.
They had gone to this guy's house and they beat this guy up. He was, I think he was the president of the JACL. And the feeling about the JACL was very bad because they said they were, you know, associated with the FBI, and the Japanese would call those people Inus.
Or dog, I guess.
Yeah. Name all the people you think are Inus. And so people would start saying, this guy and that guy, he lives over here and here and there. And they're going to divide up and go to all these people they named and beat them up.
For various reasons, Manzanar was a divided population on the eve of the unrest. To some degree, the divisions predated the camp. Manzanar's population came mostly from Los Angeles, and tensions around Little Tokyo had been on the rise prior to the attack on Pearl Harbor. According to Togo Tanaka, the English section editor of the Rafu Shimpo newspaper, and later a key figure in the unrest, several months before Pearl Harbor, the Japanese expression Inu was being applied to some JACL leaders due to rumors that some were talking to the FBI and official of naval intelligence. After the attack on Pearl Harbor, further actions of JACL leaders aroused anger. Some formed the Anti-Axis Committee, which operated outside of Los Angeles' JACL office, and took a strong patriotic stand in an attempt to sway public opinion against drastic actions towards Japanese Americans. Tokutaro Slocum, a leader of the community, later boasted before the Tolan Committee that he had turned in names of fellow Japanese Americans to the FBI. Fred Tayama, a local JACL leader and Los Angeles businessman, was accused of exploiting Issei fears in the weeks prior to the mass removal by charging them exorbitant fees for simple services. In general, many Japanese Americans, particularly Issei and Kibe, objected to the JACL strategy of encouraging cooperation with the mass removal, viewing those who promoted such an approach as race traitors. Once in the camp, broken promises and high turnover administrators stoked inmate frustrations. Manzanar had begun under the administration of the Wartime Civil Control Administration, or the WCCA, a branch of the Army, and later transferred to the War Relocation Authority, the WRA. It had five managers, project directors, in its first 8 months of operation, and promises made under one administration were often broken by succeeding ones. In one example, WCCA manager Clayton E. Triggs promised inmates much higher salaries for work done in the camp than what was actually implemented. Salary checks were also late, with the first ones not arriving for 3 months after the work had been completed. Many of the WRA administrators were disliked by inmates, with one in particular, Assistant Project Director Ned Campbell, drawing near universal scorn for his condescending and short-tempered approach. Inmates were also widely believed that several staffers were stealing supplies, such as sugar, and selling them outside the camp on the black market. Campbell was among those suspected, accused by Harry Ueno, the popular leader of the Mess Hall Workers Union. For these and other reasons, animosity towards the administration and by association, the Japanese American inmates who worked with them. Through the fall, a variety of occurrences added fuel to the smoldering resentments. Most block managers at Manzanar under WCCA administration were Issei or Kibe. But in the line with the WRA regulations that favored placing American citizen Nisei in leadership's positions, the camp administration sought to install a committee council whose membership would be limited to Nisei in place of the existing block leaders' council. Many of the Nisei who sought leadership posts were associated with the JACL, including Tayama, who was elected chairman of the Manzanar Work Corp, and Tanaka, who headed the Commission on Self-Government. Pro-JACL Nisei, in coalition with Nisei leftists, communists, also formed the Patriotic Manzanar Citizens Federation, which advocated working with the administration to improve camp conditions and allow Nisei to serve in the U.S. Armed Forces. Early meetings of the Federation were contested by heated opposition from Joe Kurihara, an embittered Nisei World War I veteran who had become a leader among Manzanar dissidents. There were also a widespread belief that some of the JACL-aligned Nisei were acting as informers to the FBI. But the immediate precipitating event to the riot uprising was Tayama's participation in the national JACL meeting in Salt Lake City in November. Among other recommendations adopted at the meeting was one advocating the Nisei eligibility for the draft be restored. When Tayama returned to Manzanar, he was a marked man.
One of the things that happened in camp was the JACL became the contact point for the feds. because we had chapters all over California, and this is a way to communicate with the community. And so the federal government selected the JACL as a communication point. That's why they knew early on and had that emergency meeting that there was going to be a so-called evacuation. And that was the cooperation meeting. They spread that information through their chapters, their delegates, about what was going on. So when the camps opened, the administrators decided they would have the JACL leaders in each of those camps become the governing body. They would be the ones to more or less set up the infrastructure, the police, the fire department, if there was a hospital, the various kinds of jobs. The worst jobs, like digging the sewer ditches and working in the kitchens, went only to the Kibbeh. Kibbehs started getting pissed off. I mean, you know, they weren't stupid. And there was always this clash between the Kibbeh and the JACL anyway. So these JACL leaders, you know, it was stupid of them. They should have realized that this was going to backfire. They exacerbated the situation in Manzanar by really sticking it to the Kibbeh. And there was a lot of anger at the JACL, and from the research I'd done, the intent was they were going to go after Tayama. They were going to kill him.
On Saturday night, December 5th, at around 8 p.m., Fred Tayama was attacked by a group of six masked intruders in his barrack room in Block 28. A young woman passing by heard a commotion and screamed, causing the attackers to disperse. An ambulance conveyed Tayama to the hospital, where he was treated for a cut scalp and other non-life-threatening injuries. Though he could not positively identify his attackers, Tayama figured Harry Ueno was one of the culprits. Ueno was taken into custody and questioned, then taken by Campbell outside of the camp to the county jail in Independence. Two other suspects were also questioned through the night, but were released early in the next morning. The next morning, a group of about 200 gathered at Block 22, Mess Hall, Ueno's block. The group met briefly and adjourned, deciding to arrange a larger meeting at 1 p.m. The 1 p.m. meeting drew a crowd of over 2,000 and spilled into a neighboring firebreak. At the meeting, angry speeches by Joe Kurihara and others called for Ueno's release under the threat of a general strike. Prevailing sentiment was that Ueno's arrest had more to do with his accusations against Campbell than any other role in the beating. In other words, he was used as a scapegoat. Kurihara also called for the death of an Innu on a death list he had made. The meeting ended with the formation of a negotiating committee of five, the COF, who would be empowered to negotiate with Camp Director Ralph Merritt. The committee included three Issei and two Kibbeh, who were named spokesmen of the group. Merritt and the acting chief internal security arrived as the meeting was breaking up, then returned to the administration building to wait for the COF. About 1:30, the COF, along with a large crowd, arrived at the administration building. By that time, commanding officer of the military police detail at Manzanar had assembled a group of about 12 soldiers who had entered the camp and who stood guard at the administration building armed with machine guns. Escaping from the unruly crowd, Merritt met with the COF and they reached an agreement. Ueno would be brought back to the jail at Manzanar and would be tried at Manzanar. In return, the COF would disperse the crowd and agree not to hold further demonstrations or to attempt to free Ueno. Kurihara spoke to the crowd, telling them they should disperse and reassemble at 6 p.m. While they did not disperse immediately, they did disperse by 3 p.m. once the MPs were moved outside of camp. Ueno was brought back to Manzanar about 3:30. At 6, a crowd, now consisting of some 2,000 to 4,000 people, convened at Block 22's mess hall and the firebreak. The COF announced the return of UNO and attempted to resign, but the crowd would not allow them. After a few speeches, including Kurihara's further elaboration of the death list of fellow inmates, headed by Tayama, and also included alleged NU Slocum, Tanaka, and others, the crowd became more agitated and two groups formed. One to go after the death list, starting with the hospitalized Tayama, the other to go to the camp jail to attempt to free UNO. Sometime after 6:30, a group of 50 to 75 people arrived at the hospital, armed with whatever weapons they had been able to find. They were held off at the door by inmate women hospital workers. Meanwhile, Dr. James Mgoto and other staff hid Tayama on the lower shelf of a bed and covered him with blankets. Believing that Tayama had been removed from the hospital already, the chief medical officer at Manzanar decided to allow five representatives of the group to search the hospital. When the group failed to find Tayama, they broke off into smaller groups to go after the others on the list. Most on the list had been tipped off and gone into hiding, so they were not found that night. A larger group of 500 arrived at the police station around 6:50 with the intent of freeing UNO.
The next thing they did was they said, okay, we'll go down to the jail, which was at the entrance to Manzanar, and take out the guy that was accused of beating up the JC. Okay, I don't know whether he was the one or not, but the crowd all went down there and they were mulling around the police station. But I remember they had the military about a foot apart all the way around the jail with Thompson submachine guns, you know. And being kids, we went down there to see what was going on, and they were singing Japanese military songs and, you know, Man and Raven and stuff. And they did this for a while, and we said, this is boring, let's get out of here. And good thing we did.
So we gathered in the Block 36 kitchen, and they started having an argument about things, the kibes, and I didn't know the guy that talked for the other side. What do you guys, calm down, and trying to hold him down. And luckily, for some reason, the Nisei sort of gently moved towards each other while they're talking. And so we're all looking at each other and passing messages, you might say. And with our heads, we nodded towards the kibe. And they were going to get killed if they started anything.
The assistant chief of internal security at Manzanar met with the COF, pointing out they had breached the agreement from earlier that day. When the assistant chief informed Merritt of the situation, which also saw inmate police having largely scattered out of fear for their lives, Merritt gave the okay to bring back MPs to restore order. The first group of MPs arrived at 7:15. As the assistant military chief police met with the COF, Merritt's attempt to get the police station were stigmatized by the crowd. The crowd grew increasingly unruly, throwing stones and taunting the MPs. When the MPs failed to break up the crowd, force was decided to be necessary. Around 9:30 p.m., tear gas was fired into the crowd, although the crowd broke up but did not disperse. In the ensuing chaos, the crowd pushed a car toward the police station, causing MPs to open fire on it. Two other MPs fired into the crowd on their own initiative. As the crowd dispersed, several casualties of the shooting remained behind. Through the night, mess hall bells tolled continuously. Various meetings were held, and several alleged Innu were beaten. When the dust had settled, one young man, 17-year-old James Ito of Los Angeles, had been killed by the gunfire. Another, 21-year-old Jim Kinagawa of Tacoma, would die of injuries several days later. The official record has 9 others that were shot but survived. Others who were there said it was a lot more.
That's when I worked at the hospital, so I know these people got shot. And there's about 15 people got shot, and one kid got killed. He was only 16 He was down there like me, watching, just curious, and he was killed. And these people that were in the hospital, they were all laying on their stomach, you know. I go, why are they laying on their stomach? Because I was bringing in the food. And they were all shot in the back, so they couldn't lay on their back. I remember that.
Groups of inmates subsequently left Manzanar. The first group consisted of the administration considered responsible for the unrest, included UNO, members of the COF, and 20 others. These men were arrested and held in jails in Lone Pine and Independence, though Tinwar later returned to Manzanar. The other 16 ultimately were sent to newly established prison camp in Utah, administrated by the WRA, then transferred to another such camp in April 1943 in Arizona. Most ended up at the post-segregation Tule Lake when Arizona closed in December. The other group to leave the camp were those who had been threatened with violence, including JACL-associated figures such as Tayama, Tanaka, Slocum, and others who had been attacked and injured on Sunday night. Initially housed at the MP's Barracks and Administration Building, 65 refugees were moved to Cow Creek Camp, adjacent to the Death Valley National Monument. The group, which included the families of some men, remained there until arrangements could be made for their resettlement outside of the restricted area. Several ultimately ended up moving to Chicago. Back at Manzanar, inmates organized anew. A group of 180 elected delegates, three from each block, formed and threatened a general strike unless UNO and others were released. Block managers also distributed black armbands, which most inmates chose to wear. An informal strike slowed camp operations, such as the schools, which remained closed until January 10. Additional military police were added, and they patrolled the camp for a few days. But gradually, conditions in the camp calmed and operations returned to normal in January as the MP's presence gradually diminished. A military investigation of the actions of the MPs in January 1943 exonerated them of any wrongdoing, concluding they were justified in firing their weapons because members of the mob were closing in and surging towards them. The mutiny, along with similar unrest in other camps, influenced the WRA in developing and implementing a policy identified and segregate the disloyal and to encourage the loyal to leave the camps and resettle in communities outside the West Coast. For those who were considered disloyal were sent to Tule Lake, where Tule Lake was further segregated.
One thing about that riot you're talking about is you have to remember that there was no real good communication. You all depended on word of mouth, and so things get distorted that way.
I was at the hospital then. We just kept very quiet, I know. Yeah. I know there are several that they brought into the hospital. Doctor was there, but we didn't do any lab work. We just sat there. Yeah. Oh, that comes to me now. I've forgotten all that. I want to just forget everything in Manzanar. I didn't like Manzanar. Ooh, I hated Manzanar. That's why I just want to get everything out of my head. I just want to forget the whole thing.
The paper
the Times paper we saw later said, Japs fighting against the army or something, the guard, riot or something to that effect, which I thought was a big lie. I never trust the paper, and I won't buy newspaper for to this date.
Had to be all threes, single shot or bolt action.
Some people say there was machine gun fire, but you didn't.
No machine gun fires. It was a little peanut popping O3s.
No bursts?
No bursts. Because those were in the towers. They didn't have any down level, because if they'd shot a... I'm surprised that they only caught one with, if it was one bullet. Because one bullet would easily penetrate three bodies.
How many shots did you recall?
I don't know, just a few. It wasn't any big, the whole place opening up, because they'd have killed a lot of people. I happened to be near the guys that were yelling, and that's when I heard, let's get Tanaka, whoever it was. And that seemed odd that they would start going after somebody, after the unplanned shooting. So anyway, it was the emotions were up or whatever. The place is alive now.
Right.
And so that's when this group started for the other group that they were looking for, which had to be the Kibes, I guess, because they spoke the Japanese. And as I found out, they were the same guys that I knew, only with they now had bands around their head, forehead.
They did.
Which is kind of strange for that time.
My father got arrested in a meeting with the camp administrator. And it was when the riots broke out. And so they kept him. I don't know where they took him. In fact, we never saw him again. And we found out from Mr. Ueno's wife, she told my mother that they were going up to Utah. They're being taken there. There was a black porter on the train who gave Harry pencil and paper, and he put an address on it, and this guy mailed it. What was interesting, I found out later, in fact, not all that long ago, maybe in the past 10 years, that my father was at Moab and Loop and was getting the crap kicked out of him because he wouldn't go along with the other Kibe. And one of the camp administrators said they needed to put him in isolation because the other Kibes were, now they were gonna go after him. And so he got moved from Moab to Loop. And the administrator there said, it's not safe for him because he doesn't agree with the other Kibe. And they kept trying to get him returned to Manzanar, but Merritt would not have him. So what happened was the director at the Loop camp, out of his own pocket, paid for my father to be sent to Topaz. Yeah.
I think the other men from Moab, did they go to Tule Lake, I think?
They all went to Tule Lake.
And your dad went to Topaz.
He went to Topaz because the director there was a friend of the guy at Loop. And he started, the director at Topaz was writing to Merritt saying, this man does not deserve to be here. He needs to be returned to his family. That he wasn't part of all this other stuff.
Tule Lake, and they said, oh, that's a bad camp, right off the bat. You have to understand, what time they moved the people in and out, there were 26,000 people went through the gates of Tule Lake. and out of 120,000 Japanese American that was relocated, 26,000 came to the gates of Two Lakes. So this camp itself, quite a few people have come through, but a lot of them that came to Two Lakes or left Two Lakes, they don't want to say they were in Two Lakes because it leaves a bad taste for a lot of people. When we talk about Two Lakes, oh, they're bad peoples. But to me, the government created that. They wanted to see who's the bad guys and good guys, but there was no proof of loyalty or disloyal. But they made this hard, fast rule of loyalty, which created a lot of problems for a lot of people. Was that right or wrong? So what happened here in Two Lake, there were about 4,000 to 5,000 people that didn't sign a loyalty oath. That was the problem. And so they felt that, well, there's 4,000 or 5,000 here already that won't sign a loyalty oath, so we'll make Two Lake a segregation center.
There was a loyalty oath questionnaire which was distributed in all the 10 camps. Question 27 asked if we would serve in the armed forces of the United States and go wherever ordered. Question 28 asked if you forswore allegiance to the Japanese emperor.
And how am I going to answer it? Because I can't forswear allegiance to the Japanese emperor because I never had allegiance to him.
Caused a lot of confusion among the Issei who were not citizens, and that meant that they would lose their Japanese citizenship if they did that, and that they would be people without a country because they couldn't become American citizens.
I was so mad, though, that they would dare to ask a question like that where it would tend to sort of break up a family.
I said no, because, to be detained in a camp like this and be asked that kind of question, I thought that was ridiculous.
Those that said that they weren't loyal are the ones that went to Tule Lake, the camp that was way up by the Oregon border. And then from there, some of them were sent to Japan.
When I'm thinking back about all the no-no boys, they were bitter about the war or they were bitter about the evacuation. They didn't want to go into the army.
Many of the young men refused to go for induction when they were called.
We had a neighbor who volunteered for the service, and at the time I thought, the guy's crazy.
I volunteered from a relocation center to show my loyalty and to prove that I had the right to live as a good American citizen.
The 442nd was part of the Department of the Army's effort to utilize Japanese Americans, but they kept them in a segregated unit.
You fought not only the enemy, but you fought prejudice, and you've won.
These fellows really put their life on the line and went out there, and a lot of them got killed.
Saddam Unamori was awarded the Medal of Honor because the German hand grenade was thrown into a group, and he threw himself on the hand grenade and sacrificed his life.
My gosh, here was a guy who gets the Congressional Medal of Honor and the mother is behind barbed wire. I thought, wow, that's justice.
To replace the heavy casualties suffered by the 442nd, government officials went to the 10 American concentration camps and started drafting Japanese American men, telling them it was their duty as U.S. citizens to fight for their country. Some thought that this was wrong and refused to report for their army physicals.
They kick us around and now you're going to have to go and prove that you're an American. That's to me, it was just pure gut. I had no intellectual understanding of this or anything. No way, you know, from my feeling, it was totally wrong. Let us take us back to Seattle, get our parents, get our hotel back, get us back into what we were. We were American. How come the German friends I had, they weren't evacuated?
300 Japanese American men did not believe that they should be forced to fight for the country that was imprisoning them and their families. The courts ruled against them, and almost all of the men were convicted of draft resistance and sent to federal prisons. After the war, Japanese Americans gradually and painstakingly rebuilt their lives. Years passed without much talk of what had happened during the war. But in the 1960s, social movements ignited change and refocused attention on past injustices. Community members examined government intelligence and military documents that showed that Japanese Americans were not a security threat and that there was little risk of a Japanese invasion to the West Coast. With pressure from the Japanese American community, a commission created by Congress was formed to examine the causes of the World War II incarceration.
When Executive Order 9066 was signed, that young man was no more. Instead, I was Mark Murakami, Japanese American, dutifully registered to be taken into protective custody.
The commission found that there was no military necessity, that the real reasons were race prejudice, war hysteria, and a failure of political leadership. Congress passed the Civil Liberties Act of 1988, offering an apology and monetary payment to those incarcerated.
We gather here today to right a grave wrong. More than 40 years ago, shortly after the bombing of Pearl Harbor, 120,000 persons of Japanese ancestry living in the United States were forcibly removed from their homes and placed in makeshift internment camps. This action was taken without trial, without jury. It was based solely on race, for these 120,000 were Americans of Japanese descent. The legislation that I am about to sign provides for a restitution payment to each of the 60,000 survivors, yet no payment can make up for those lost years. So what is most important in this bill has less to do with property than with honor, for here we admit a wrong. Here we reaffirm our commitment as a nation to equal justice under the law.
Eventually, 82,000 Japanese Americans received a presidential apology and a $20,000 payment. For many, the painful memories of incarceration inspire them to fight for justice.
You should speak out because if it could happen to you, it could happen to anybody. As long as you're a minority, they can pick on you and they can incarcerate you as they did us. But if you get out there and speak out loud, I think you will be able to combat those type of things. We should go out there and tell the people and make them remember that this should never happen again.
Give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the high-flying city that I love. Don't fence me in. Let me be by myself in the evening breeze. Listen to the murmur of the tall concrete. Send me off forever, but I ask you, please, don't fence me in. Now put the spin in my wheels, let me run away with my thoughts. Don't fence me in. Say freedom is the word, heaven's own work of art. Don't fence me in. I wanna ride to the ridge where the view commences. Gaze at the moon till I lose my senses. My heart stays on the road cause I can't stand fences. Don't fence me in. Don't fence me in.